Hi guys, my name is Kamil. I'm a lead designer at Quipu. Do any of you know Quipu? No? Okay. Quipu is a cloud accounting software that tackles two main business problems of modern world. One of them is automatizing accounting processes for companies and administrative processes because they rarely bring any value. They're just time-consuming and so on. And another one is to help people get paid faster. And I'm here to, well, in Quipu to help people solve their main problems like this. Design to code. Before we start, how many of us here is front-end developers today? Okay. How many of us is designers? Okay. How many of us never use design software? Okay. Right. So even if you're not a professional designer and never used design software before, and you're just coding, you can still release products, apps that do the job, and are well designed if you follow a simple process I'm about to lay out for you. So I'm going to show you a quick process of how I think you should be doing it and how I do it day to day. The side note here is it's not a complete UX process, so don't expect that. I'm showing you how to do well-structured and informed approach to design. And just to make it clear, I will be referring to you and myself as us, because we often face same problems and walk the same shoes in our day-to-day jobs. So, some more questions. How many of you have their own projects? How many of you are thinking to have to release some side projects? Okay, cool. Someone has their products released already, or okay. So, as some of you know already, in today's development of apps, it's more important than ever to deliver them fast and well designed. In order to acquire users before someone else does, right? And in order to do that, we have to make sure we do the three key things right. And they are, oh yes, right. Number one is planning. We have to plan our design, and I'm going to show you how in a minute. Number two is design, and of course, to code them. So how do we plan our own project? And by the way, I'm talking from the perspective of how to plan it good for the incoming coding ahead. So so our design to code process is relatively easy and enjoyable, in fact. So number one is the goal. Goal is something that you have to define before you start any work. So for example, at Quipu, the goal of our app that I'm going to show you later is to provide fast access to data and allow for quick processing of expenses. And in context, the main goal of it is to, when people have like five free minutes on the train or idle time, and they want to use their time effectively, they can go to our app, do the snaps of their expense receipts, and send it to Quipu, and we will process it with some help from some technologies, and then they can just go and verify their expenses. Right. Ta-da. So yeah, above the goal, as I already said, is to provide fast access to company's financial overview and fast tracking of expenses. In terms of audience, we need to know the basic demographics, who these people are, what context they're going to be using our app in, and their devices. And yeah, that's pretty much it. More planning, we have to do the flowchart, which will give you, will lay out all the steps of what your users have to go through in order to accomplish whatever problem you solve with their goal. And this will allow you to, you know, make some tweaks to the flow and define better ways of doing it instead of, you know, just hard coding it. By not doing this step, we expose ourselves to danger of changing everything when you actually code. And the next thing comes from flowchart, which will be functional definition. And functional definition is is a simple document. I actually have some examples so I can show you. So going back to flowchart a bit.
Are you recording your screen, by the way?
Yes, I am. No problem. So this is a simple flowchart. I'm not sure if we can read it. The resolution is sort of bad. So those windows are basically screens. This is UI kit to do flowcharts. Those are screens. For example, here we have a splash screen when people land on our app. Our app has to verify it if they are authenticated, if they have to log in or they don't. So let's say that, like, yes, success. So in here we have a logical condition. What happens in both cases? In here we have success, so we go on, or we go to login registration and other flows of forget a password and so on. After that, here is, do I have information in my account? Those are questions. If I don't have it, then I show dashboard. If I don't have it, I show dashboard with onboarding of creating how to create the first invoice, how to do this, how to do that. It's guiding people to do what you want them to do and what they want to do using your app. And so on. And then from dashboard, we have a menu that we can access anytime on the left or on the bottom. That's up to you. The point is that you define your routes here and all the steps. What happens now? What happens after this button, after that button, while completing any action? And then we have our functional definition, which, for example, come back. I'll start from module. Can everybody read it? Okay. I like to have a division between view and module. And what's the difference? Module, as we can see here, is something that contains information. In this case, we store information about the series of the ticket. This is income ticket, by the way. So the series number of it, the number of ticket in order, issue date, client, as you can see, all these things. Then what partial information we allow to show for it, but since it's very simple, we don't do partial views for that. And then more important here is list information, and that is what goes to views. So essentially a view is a view that shows you multiple modules. It shows information from collected modules or just one. The point is views do not store information, and that's how I like to divide it. But what's more important, you always have to write purpose for each screen. Why is it in your application? And to do this, you have to work a bit on your flows. And also another step from it is routes and actions that you can take. And they also come from your flowcharts. Why is this useful? It's useful because when you go further down to development of your apps, you know what routes to establish. You don't have to be personal knowledge base for everyone in the team. You just share this document with them and they can go there and see everything they need to know about the project. And then the views. Come on. So as I said before, we have the view, which is incomes list. Again, the purpose for it. And then what full information we show on the list. And by this, I mean only what's in the single list item, which is, I think for this one, it was the series, the number, the client, and the total amount. And then actions and routes. I can go back to menu, I can do a quick preview of the item, or I can add the income, invoice, or the ticket. And you make sure you do it for every screen in your app. No matter how many you have there. Some patterns will just be repeated screen by screen, but that's okay. Okay. So that is planning. I might be talking a little bit fast, so if you have any questions, make sure you ask them. You can ask them now. Do you have any questions? Any issues? All clear? Okay, fantastic. Number two is a design, something I'm a bit better at planning and coding, but right. Very important thing when it comes to design is to use established patterns. We don't have to try to reinvent wheels. It's already been done. And even if so, whatever problem you're facing, and you're not sure which pattern to use, whether it's a pattern can be a bottom navigation bar, it can be a hamburger menu, it can be a search on the same screen without refreshing the page, it can be search on another page. Those patterns are done, and you only have to think about what context I'm going to use this pattern in. And in order to do so, we go to point number two, which is ux.stackexchange.com. And if you're not sure about a good UX, you make sure you go there, because these problems that we will be facing in our design process are answered right there. So yeah, take a photo of it. And number three. Since it's not a real, full UX process, I would say do wireframes and rapid prototypes before your real designs, just in case we were wrong about our flows and we can quickly pass it around and just test our app with real people. That will allow us to do so without wasting so much time on designing and coding after all. Number four, it is my favorite. It's designed as you would code it. And let me open that. And by that I mean, let's see if this will be visible here. 1 second. So design as you would code it means use containers and wrappers in your designs. Do you guys know Sketch? How many of you have Mac? Oh, okay, I'll be talking about Sketch tonight. How many have Photoshop to do designs? Okay, and Illustrator? Anyone? Okay, yeah. Adobe Suite. I find Sketch to be the best tool, at least for my preferences and for what I do every day. And I'll show you a few simple reasons why later on. But going back to design as you would code it, is very simple. Let's go to layouts. This is one screen of our app. It's a list of your income invoices or tickets. And it's designed with using 8 pixels grid. Okay, let's go here, because it's switched on. Let's keep that grid. What's important here, I put all the elements in a wrapper of the big header, which has the exact dimension it's going to have on the screen and exact properties. Next thing is, I always put containers and wrappers around icons to make them bigger, like a clickable area. And also, I'm always trying to use some naming conventions for the items. This is guide, so you won't see it here. But I always name my files. They should always be well named so that you and your colleagues, when you collaborate, know what it is. And again, the screen title, the background. Oh, I didn't name it, and the shadow for it. So what it also means, and I think it's better shown in another piece of software, which is this one. Any of you guys know Zeppelin? How many? Oh, not many. Okay. So Zeppelin is a smart tool that takes your Sketch or Photoshop designs and gives you all the CSS, most of CSS you will ever need to in order to code your products, your websites or apps. And it's really cool when you see it like this. Because it always gives us dimensions, and when you design it as you would code it, you always have. when you design as you would code it, on the screen with all the containers, you already know, you designed your divs, you designed your containers in your HTML. And by doing it this way, you make sure you don't have to spend some more time thinking about how will I lay out the elements on the page. The rest that's required of you is to just put the CSS in. Is that clear, by the way? Do I have to explain a bit more? Any questions? No? Yes, first?
Do you design the classes like shape there? Is it decided in Sketch?
Right.
Can you reuse it in different components?
So, unfortunately, it's not that smart to give you the class names. For now, it's our job to when we code our components, it's our job to use namings and component structure and make sure to paste the correct CSS from Zeppelin to the component files. We cannot reuse. Some of the code we can reuse, and I'll show you later, but not always. And it usually comes down to copying and pasting from here, instead as opposed to calculating and guessing the styles. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, more or less. Okay. I have to check how it's done.
Okay, yeah, feel free to come over later on. I can show you on my computer. Yes?
So it's giving the dimensions in pixels. I'm not an expert on mobile development, but mm-hmm. I wonder if wouldn't it be better to make it relative dimensions so it's more...
Yes. Good question. No, it doesn't give you the relative dimensions, at least not always. If you want relative dimensions, it does line height, for example. In here, for example, we have 40 pixels of line height. And I code it this way because I don't want to apply extra paddings, for example. I designed it this way, sorry. Because I don't want to apply extra paddings to position it, so it's always line height. But in this case, it gives you the relative to the base font size. But dimensions are given in pixels. In mobile development, we also have to use relative dimensions. It's not just fixed pixels. This is for iPhone 6. I can lay out things on the screen with relative pixels. But that's not a problem. What's most important here is that by using the 8 pixels grid, good question. I actually don't know. I think it's both because, it's hard to put relative dimensions and make everything responsive as you design, unfortunately. For website development, responsive development, this is also responsive a bit because it's for multiple devices, but for website development, we have to use grid systems. We should. And by having... By knowing the number of columns we have some element in, we don't really need to use the relative dimensions in many cases because we have them. We have the width by a percentage of the whole page, and many oftentimes it's up to us to code other things in relative dimensions. Answer your question.
Yeah, Sketch is. I don't know Sketch, but it's more for mobile or it's also.
It's for anything. It's for general UI design. Can be web or mobile apps. You had a question?
So this only works with CSS, but with native, could you use it for native Android apps or?
You can.
If it would give you style.
Good question. To be honest, I don't know. Is Zeppelin? I don't think Zeppelin does. Any support for native apps. Any more questions? Okay. Next. Anyone familiar with atomic design? One, two people, three. Okay, I'm gonna just talk quickly through it. Atomic design is a design approach that gives us really good principles to start your designs from atoms the smallest possible particles of our design of our UI elements to molecules that are formed from multiple atoms, then to form organisms with multiple molecules, and then with multiple organisms we call it layouts. And that so a page is essentially built from multiple. It's one layout built of multiple organisms, which are built of multiple molecules, which are built of multiple molecules. And I'm going to show you what it means. Come back. Atomic. This is a really simplified version of atomic, but for example, font is an atom. Here we have three different ones. Color is another one. Then we have shapes and things like this. And for example, a button is a molecule. It's a mixture of three molecules. It's a shape of the button. It's a text style on it, and it's a color of it. So that's a molecule. To build a sign-up form for newsletter, for example, to have put your email address here and sign a button, we have to use two molecules, a sign-up form, the input field, which has label, which has input text style within, and the container for it. And then another molecule will be our sign-up button, and this will form organism for us. And more of them on a page is a layout then. For more information, I encourage you to go to this link. This one. Want to take a picture or something. Why is this important? Because if at any point we want to change something in our designs, we don't have to go on every screen. And Sketch works really well with symbols. And symbols are reusable pieces of design that you can just tweak and modify and from one place, and they will be updated everywhere else. I think in Photoshop it's called layer comps, if I'm right. Everyone noted the site? Okay. Where is it? Okay. So, for example, here I have my list item for income. And I have generic contact name, which is a placeholder for any list item in the layout itself. And let's go ahead and change its. Maybe not this one. Let's change this one. And in this one, we have another piece, which is the container, which is another atom. Come back. It's hard for me to do on different dimension screens like this. And let's say we want to give this one a background like this. And this should allow us to have it everywhere, updated everywhere. And this goes for text styles, this goes for everything else. So that's why it's important to design the molecules like this, because then you can apply some principles in here. For example, what I've done, and this is using 8 pixels grid, I set up a set of rules that this gap for here, for instance, is 16 pixels, and this one is 8, and we always have icon location here, which is also another symbol that I can update anytime from anywhere. So when you send your designs or you code them yourself, but let's say we collaborate and I send my designs to other developers, I don't have to go on every screen and change something because suddenly we had a shift in focus in our project, and I don't have to go and say, okay, this is wrong, I updated 5 screens for you, please change it. You can just go and export this one. Export this into Zeppelin. I already did. I'll show you how it's done later on. Income item. Oh. It's So any change I make, I just send him this little element. And that also allows me to give them any special cases that we have without necessity of doing another 50 screens. Is that clear? Do you have any questions? OK.
I have a question.
Yes, go ahead.
How do you manage, so say you're iterating on some design, and you've already given it to developers and they've created it, and then maybe you make some changes to atom or molecule mechanism. How do you, as a designer, manage the different versions you have and then communicate that with the developers?
Good question. So in my sketch files, this is just a presentation one, but in the work files that we have here in Quipu, and also why I love using Sketch, come back, is because we have these pages, and pages contain artboards. And I have my versioning set up right there that allows me to track different versions. Also, Zeppelin does version control for your uploads there, and we can change. Actually, let me show you because I think I updated something there. Yes. So I just have one version, but this is a version control, and you can switch back at any time, and use the generated code from this one. And then how we manage, we basically agree on version number 3 or 4 or whichever version it is and go ahead with it. And the process is quite flexible. If you do the atomic design and you're able to change many things at any time in the process, with one exception, we do not change flows mid-project. Everything else is quite flexible. Answer your question?
Yeah, that's really cool.
Any more questions? Okay, let's move on. Now, third part of the presentation is coding, which I'm not going to be teaching you how to code because you guys are much better than me. But I already mentioned Zeppelin here. And I think that in our process, this was the single most time-saving improvement that we implemented into the workflow because we don't spend so much time on our layouts. And also by designing as you would code it, We already designed our div structure. In Sketch, we already have our tree structure of the project, of the components of the project, and we don't have to spend too much time on this. So, for us here, it's more important to prepare before we start coding, in order to then translate our designs much faster into code. Right. So, any more questions about that? Right. I know we had some things about automation as well with the announcement of the presentation. And there's one important thing why Sketch is good. It's because it allows for many integrations. And one of them, which helps us the most, me, when I design, is called Craft. And it's also available for Photoshop. Anyone heard of Craft? 2 people? 3? Okay. So in short, Craft is a little Swift plugin. It's blue. That allows me to get dummy data from anywhere, whether it's from external database or from some dummy source. And how it works is very simple. For example, I didn't really invent those names. Craft did it for me, really. So I go here, and I say I want some names, male, female, or both. And I click on that, and the names get updated. And it's not only names. If I want, I can do the same with numbers and dates, or custom element, for example. Let's say, I have status. Let's change status. Instead of the pending, due, and paid status, let's say I want to have I don't know, 3 animals. So, 3 animals, and cat, giraffe, dog, some more animals, whale, What else? Cal? Okay, yeah, that's okay, we have five. I think it's enough. We can preserve order or we don't have to. I'll go without because we want to randomize our thing. And when I click this one, I get anything I want. So this allows us to go to any website, get a list of, I don't know, countries or of some names, emails, or so even some more industry specific. I was working with mortgage brokers in the United States, and we had some specific terms and specific values in our data tables. And what I've done, I set up all the custom sketch, custom craft data points, and with just five clicks, I've had a whole table of five columns filled in with data without an effort. And it's not only text, it also goes for pictures. So let's say I want to go and hide some parts. First letter. Okay. I'm going to go ahead and hide it. I'll come back. Okay, let's just delete them. And then we have the circles for contact. So let's say I want to have some nice profile pictures for these people. We go here, we go to photos, and we have people. That's it. Well, it should be randomized. I'm not sure why it's not. Okay, I think it's because this is an old version, but yeah. Basically gives you photos. You can do it one by one instead of going to website, getting it from some Tumblr, and so on. On my new version, it does it randomly. I don't know why it does it now. But you can do it with any picture. And also what's cool, you can just go to a browser, go to any page, and take content from a page as you design in Sketch. Or if you go hardcore, you can just do JSON. You can just get your API rolling into your designs. Craft, C-R-A-F-T. Yes? Yes, it has multiple plugins like this. No, Craft is by InVision. Do you guys know InVision?
Yeah.
Craft is by InVision and it's completely free.
What about the Sketch? Is it free?
No, Sketch has 30 days trial for free. And why it's also good, because you only pay, I think, $99 or $129. I can't remember exactly now, but you pay once. You don't have subscription like with Adobe products. It has some advantages.
But it's only for Mac,
right? Unfortunately, yes.
No, I version for Linux?
No, and why it's for Mac also? It's because what you see here, they are all native Mac OS X components. All the UI of Sketch is based on Mac native. There's no custom UI to it. It's so light and fast because it's meant to be. I don't think there will be ever a version for it, but I can't speak for the creators of the program.
Do you know any
alternatives
like
Yes. Do you know what? You can ask me this question about the alternative of the time. There is one browser, I just can't remember the name now. There is one browser design tool that almost like Sketch. It does the same job really well, and it's also not slow if you think about it. It's quite fast as for a design tool in the browser. Make sure you catch me later now. Yes. I'll have to Google that. Do you have any more questions? No? Okay. So that is my design to code process. I like to work this way, and I encourage you today when you finish the nice beers we all have and some networking, go and do your flows and make sure you plan your apps properly before you start coding. That will make it easier and actually enjoyable. I'm getting into development now, and without this, I don't know if I will enjoy it so much. So thanks very much for your time. You have a question.
Yeah. How do you deal with, say, if you give a design to the developers, mm-hmm. come back to you and they say, well, I guess this would maybe be at the flow stage, that this flow might not work for technical reasons.
Right? Yes.
Or it would be incredibly difficult for us to implement it this way. Is there something else? How do you deal with that?
Good question. Hey, Pau. This is something we work closely with the development team. On the establishing of flows, there are all teams present. It's not just me doing some flowy things. It's a whole team effort. And we agree on things that we know are possible. And frankly, the only difficulties we have at the end is maybe we have an animation that I went too crazy with, and you say, okay, with the way our current app is structured or with technologies we use, it's not possible to have it with the performance we want to, so then we find alternatives, but it never happened that, oh, we have a flow problem, no. Any more questions?
You have that
what? Oh, sorry, no, you had some?
You have that slide somewhere?
Yes, I have slides.
Yeah.
Those slides?
Yeah.
They can be. I can do it briefly after the presentation. Yes?
Yeah, regarding that question, I was thinking that sometimes I get a design and it's a bit difficult to adapt it to mobile or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And I cannot be all the time with the designer to tell them, don't do that because it's very difficult. Please do this.
Okay.
I suppose that with time you get better and you understand what's difficult and what's not. And maybe also by designing with Sketch, you already design with atoms and molecules and
exactly.
You already know that some things are repeated in
yes.
different places. But I don't know, how do you do that?
So your question is, when the designer is not understanding if something will work or not before he gives you the designs? Did I understand it correctly?
Well, what I was wondering is, when you're designing, maybe you show the design to the developers and they say, can you change that?
Oh, yes, no, it's a conversational process. It's not like, you know, the designer does the job and then walks off. It's constant working together.
Uh-huh.
And
so you show them
yes.
all the time what you're doing?
It's not all the time.
Time.
Yes. Very important part is to get your process sorted first, and get your technological limitations so that the designer knows beforehand what's not possible. That eliminates some of these problems. Otherwise, as I said already, it's a constant discussion and constant communication between us. It's not usually it's on a daily basis. But it's not like we have to sit next to each other and talk. Does that answer your question? Go ahead.
Where in your process you do like validation of your design, when it goes out to live users, you have to validate that before.
Yeah, we do it before. Know. Yes.
So how do you do that?
Okay, good question. It's not in here because it wasn't a UX process to validate your ideas. But when we have the wireframes before real design, of course, before we validate the documentation and the flows and that we think that it works and do some sketches, even some paper prototypes that say, okay, we have a screen here, we have buttons here and this and that. And we just could talk to people, is this easy enough? It's clean or something. Then when we come to having wireframes designed, I usually use Azure. Do you guys know Azure? Prototyping tool,
yeah.
Or Adobe XD, well, it's a like Sketch, but InVision or something?
Yeah.
Yes. So then we have wireframes, we put them into a prototype, or we do the wireframes in the prototyping tool already, and I essentially build the whole app in the prototype before I do anything else. I usually have it on my phone as well. There are some tricks you can do to have it look like an app, for example, but websites work too. And that's when what I do, I do interviews. I invite people over, I record their screens, their voices, and I see how they use it. I give them a task, and they perform the task. And that's what how I see. I spot early problems before we actually go into design. It often happens that we go back in the process because some things were wrong. So that's really, really important to do a prototype before.
Follow-up question.
Yeah, go ahead.
How do you do recordings? Like, do you plan scenarios for them? Like, what do you use for that?
Yes. I'm usually writing a script that says, it's basically a briefing. It has the task, all the login credentials that you might need, task details like data, what to input here, what to input there, organizational things. And the scenario basically is the task is written in the brief, and people shouldn't talk to me. I only ask them to speak out loud as they perform the test, and speak what they think. So, for example, I have that button here. I'm not sure what it does. I'll try it here, maybe. And okay, I'll click this. Oh, and surprise, for example. And I know what's not really good there. I ask them to speak loudly. Don't ask me questions as you go, because I'm not going to be there when you're going to be using the app, of course. So, yes. Does that answer your question? Yep. Any more questions? Okay, so yeah, thanks again for your time. I hope I helped you with your future development of and design of your apps. One important thing is Quipu is hiring right now, and if there is any good developers on the audience today, and I'm sure they are, you can catch me off the stage, or you can send me a ping on Twitter or LinkedIn, and I'll get in touch with you, or just talk to me and we exchange details and send me your CVs. Thanks very much.